Thank you for the invitation and for the nice words. I'm very happy to be here, and it was very interesting to hear Dominique tell about the questions and the worries that there are in France, because I think they're very similar things that are happening in the Netherlands. So I will start my presentation. So this spring and summer, the exhibition Slavery was on show in the Rijksmuseum that you see here. It's the National Museum of the Netherlands of Art and History, and it's based in Amsterdam. It was a temporary exhibition made by four curators of the history department, but with a much larger impact on the organization as a whole, as well as on the permanent presentation in our galleries. Not yet. Sorry. Stop. Yeah, okay, I'll stay here. So the exhibition focused on the Dutch colonial period from the 16th century till the 19th century. And in the Dutch context, 600,000 people were enslaved and taken across the Atlantic Ocean to the Americas. An even larger number of people was transported to different locations around the Indian Ocean, Asia, and East Africa. And this new economic world system also changed the Netherlands itself. It was the first time the Rijksmuseum addressed this theme in an exhibition. And to make this history more relatable to all of our visitors, we decided to focus on 10 personal true stories. You see their names here on the left, of people who held in slavery and slave owners, people who profited from the system, and those who spoke against the system. But before I will tell you about our search for faces and names, objects, and other sources, I will start a short trailer of a documentary made by Ida Doos. She is a documentary maker who followed us for about 3 years while we were preparing the exhibition, and it will give you a bit of an insight of the preparations.
In de koloniale periode is het legaal gemaakt om van mensen objecten te maken. Maar die grote blinde vlek, alsof het gewoon zomaar was, dat is waar we nu verandering in moeten brengen.
Het woord neger wordt in de slavernijperiode gebruikt als cargo, tussen de producten op de inventarislijsten.
Slavernij in de VOC-gebieden was veel groter dan in het transatlantisch gebied. VOC-mentaliteit is mensen tot slaaf maken en uitmoorden.
De emotie die dat bij mij oproept, dat is het verdriet. Onbegrip, hoe kon dat?
Wat mij betreft, wat moeten we nog veel leren als, hè, als mensheid?
Liever geven we er de voorkeur aan om groepen mensen juist niet naar hun huidskleur te benoemen.
Ik heb me wel laten overtuigen door een slaaf gemaakt. Degelijk met de discussie, maar sommige veranderingen van terminologie denk
ik. Stapje voor stapje.
Alles is anders bij deze tentoonstelling. Ik ben me veel meer bewust van mijn eigen kleur, van mijn eigen perspectief.
I would always do my best to make sure that I hold on to the heritage and not be afraid of or ashamed of it.
Times they are changing. Zoals ze zouden zeggen, Black Lives Matter. Ook in schilderijen.
So, as you can see, it was a very special project that expanded beyond the walls of our museum and beyond the 3-month period that the exhibition was on show. And we are very grateful that Ida Doos allows us with her film to show how difficult the process was and how much help we got from the outside. And here you can see the team. So on the upper left, it's the four women and the curators of the history department. Down below is Afaina de Jong. She is an architect and she made a beautiful design of the exhibition. Jurgen Tjonafong is a theater maker, and he helped us with the narration and the narration arcs. of the exhibition. And then here on the right you see our think tank, and they were very important. There was a group of people from all kinds of backgrounds, young, older, men, women, activists, scientists, and everything in between. And it really shows how big the group was that helped us make this exhibition. So I will now give you a short oversight of the objects and stories that we selected to tell this story. And here you see the atrium where the exhibition started. And there were all kinds of bells on display. And they come from Indonesia, Guyana, Suriname, Curacao, and South Africa. And they were used on plantations to indicate the rhythm of the day. Of the working day. And the sound of the bells carried far and was therefore a very practical way to reach many people over a longer distance. But for people in slavery, the sound became associated with violence, with punishment, because at the end of each day, it was determined whether enough had been harvested, and if not, punishment was very harsh. And this shows how there are many perspectives to this history and also to the objects associated with this history. And we try to keep that idea in mind while making this exhibition and while selecting the objects for this exhibition. People were taken from their homes and transported to other faraway countries with violence. And here they were forced to leave their family ties, language, cultures, and religions. And this made resistance very difficult and made people almost anonymous. When they had survived the crossing, they were sold to new slaveholders and they gave them new names like Lucky, Chocolate, or January. Not names that were given to them by their parents, but European names and easily for Europeans to pronounce. And sometimes they were even branded with the initials of their new owners. And to tell this part of the story, we used modern art. This is an installation called La Bouche du Roi by the Beninese artist Romuald Hazoumé. And it is about the hardship of the journey across the ocean. Densely packed as cargo in the hold of a ship, leaving family, culture, and language behind on the way to an unknown place and life. Hazoumé collected 304 petrol cans, which young men in Benin use for the illegal and hazardous transport of gasoline. The men heat the cans until they almost burst to increase their capacity, so that they hold as much petrol as possible. Just as people in slavery were exploited to the extreme and then replaced by a new person. So each petrol case, as you can see, is a mask with unique features and represents a human being with a name, a voice, and a culture. There are smaller masks for the women and children, and broken ones for the people who died along the way. And sounds and smells are also had an important part in this installation. And there was a video attached to it that shows the effect of this history on present-day Benin, of the people that were left behind. So facts and numbers are, of course, very important when we talk about slavery and slave trade. But we didn't want that to be central in this exhibition. For us, it was most important to make those men, women, and children that were made into anonymous cargo human again. And in the next slides, I will give you an introduction to a couple of the individuals we chose for this exhibition. Like Opian, one of our 10 characters, of her we have this impressive portrait by Rembrandt. And it enables us to tell how she and her two husbands profited economically from slavery by refining Brazilian sugar in Amsterdam. But how do you tell a story about people in slavery who were part of a system that forbade them to own property or to write? About people who were regarded as objects instead of human beings? As was the case with João, the first of our 10 stories. He was an African man who was enslaved in Elmina in Ghana and was forced to work on a sugar plantation in Brazil. And at the center of the room that you see here, there is a tronco, a multiple foot stock made in the Netherlands. Troncos are found on former sugar plantations in Brazil where they were used for punishment or to prevent fleeing during the night. And we know of João's existence through an archival document that you can see on the left, which was really the centerpiece of this room. And in this document, João was questioned by the Dutch about the position of the Portuguese and their sugar production. And from the document, we learn his name, where he comes from, and we can literally read what he said. And João is a source of information for the Dutch. His knowledge is of strategic value in the war against the Portuguese. And knowing about his role gives us a deeper understanding of people held in slavery. But since violence was never far away in the system, both the Tronco and the archival record have a central place in the story. The central object in the next gallery is this kappa from Suriname. It's a big iron kettle, you could say. And it was used to boil the sugar cane juice. And this object counterbalances the often idyllic depiction of plantation landscapes in paintings which were commissioned by slave owners and which you can see on the right. So what does this kappa tell us about Wally, the central figure in this story, and who is a man born into slavery on a Surinamese plantation? Well, it doesn't only allow us to tell about the hard work on sugar plantation, but it also stands for the craftsmanship of people held in slavery, and therefore the dependence on the slaveholders on their knowledge. Like many of the objects in the exhibition, this object as well holds different meanings. Archival documents played an important role throughout the exhibition, but especially in this part of the exhibition. It's the story of Van Bengalen. And Van Bengalen of Bengal refers to the hundreds of thousands of men, women, and children who were enslaved around the Bay of Bengal in northeast India and transported to places where the Dutch East India Company was active. So via Batavia, modern-day Jakarta, to the Banda Islands, Cape Town in South Africa, and even the Netherlands. And they were given new names, to which was added the toponym Van Bengalen of Bengal, referring to the place where they came from or where they were last traded. And archives in Jakarta and Cape Town in the Netherlands contain many references to these enslaved men and women and give glimpses of their lives, their despair and resilience, and their skills. But are objects and documents enough to do these stories justice? They were made in a colonial context from a colonial perspective. And even if you have direct quotes, as was the case with João, as I told you earlier, there was always a colonial intermediary writing down these words. But there are more sources that we can consider to tell this story. For example, oral sources, like songs that originated in slavery and tell about the experience of slavery. Songs from Curaçao, Suriname, and South Africa. And this is actually the first room where you would enter the exhibition, and where we started out making this claim, saying, well, perhaps oral sources give you a better understanding of the lives of enslaved people than archival sources do. Because these songs are about the pain of parents who couldn't protect their children, of families being ripped apart, and the feeling to be seen as no more than a tool. And they tell us other things about the lives of the enslaved. So these oral sources made it necessary for us to make a mandatory audio tour, or a mandatory, I mean, you could always choose not to do it, but you would lose a part of the experience. And here you see the narrators. Glenn Helberg on the upper left, he is a psychiatrist from the Netherlands who specializes in transcultural therapy, and he took the visitor through the exhibition. And each of the 10 stories was told by a different narrator. You can see them here, and they were people that feel connected to the historical individual, perhaps because of their name, their roots, or family history. And these 10 narrators made it clear to the visitor that the history of slavery is not only something of the past, but it continues into the present, and that the history of slavery is a history of all of us. It was important to us to have a place at the end of the exhibition where visitors could do something with the probably hard emotional experience they went through going through the exhibition, to not just say goodbye, thank you, and have them leave on their bikes, but let them have the final word. And that's why we ended the exhibition with Look at Me Now, a cooperation with two artists, Tirso Marta and David Bade, of Instituto Buena Vista in Curaçao. And they invited visitors to work with them on 10 new artworks based on the 10 stories from the exhibition. And this really grew out to be so much more than we initially thought, because they always told us they had really difficult interactions with the public, because they came with all these emotions, either sadness or anger, and they really had to talk to them and just give them a moment to share what they wanted to share, and then transform it into these artworks. So the one on the left is a sort of monument for João, and it's completely made out of cardboard labels where people could just say what they thought. And it was very impressive. So to have this exhibition be ready for the public and now even done, it seems like it has always been here, but of course that was not the case at all. For the last 4 years, we have spent most of the time trying to find a way to do justice to this history while using structures that aren't designed to do this history justice. And we had to talk and discuss and argue about stretching the limits of an exhibition and what it can show, to actually be able to tell this story in a museum. And then there was the question of how we could make this project durable. We didn't want everything to go back to normal after we closed the exhibition. And so one of the things was to be as transparent as possible during the making, as you can see in the documentary, and take as many people as possible with us in the process. So we, as I said, were followed by a documentary crew. We had talks and discussions with people from outside the museum, but also with our traditional stakeholders. For example, the Friends of the Museum. You also saw that in the trailer where the older men said, oh, now I finally understand the terminology. And in a couple of well-attended meetings, we could explain these friends of the museum things as why an exhibition on slavery was necessary and the importance of terminology in different perspectives. But we also made video clips for our colleagues to tell them about our exhibition and tested our plans with our colleagues in test panels. And then there was our permanent display in the main building, where not a lot of attention was given to slavery. So while we were in one part of the museum completely changing everything, we would walk through the main galleries and think, where is it? So as a first step, we decided to research the objects in our main building and see what links there were with slavery. And this resulted in 75 new labels, as you can see here. The gray one is the old one, and the white one is the new one. And these new labels show the ways people in the Netherlands profited from slavery or were connected to slavery and the presence of black people in the Netherlands. And after this year, we will remove them and make new labels that will combine both the old and the new texts. And also, what we will also do is put new acquisitions as the kapa, the big iron kettle, and the tronco, the footstock. We will give them a place in the permanent exhibition. And that's actually where we are now, finding a way to put more of the slavery stories in, put the new objects that are really big, so it's all much more difficult when you actually have to do it than when you were thinking about it, and evaluating the text and see where we want to add more of the slavery story. Through the years, this project became just bigger and bigger, and I could have told you about so many more aspects of this project, but unfortunately, I only had 20 minutes. And unfortunately, also the exhibition is now closed, but you can still see it online. We have made video tours for the website that show the 10 different stories and use the audio of the audio tour, and it gives you an idea of the exhibition. And of course, there's also the book. Thank you.